This is a hearing on the Addison County natural gas pipeline, and it's being convened by the Department of Public Service, not the Public Service Board, the department. It's an important distinction. The handouts describe the difference, and one of the speakers will also speak to that. But I just wanted you to be clear that it's a meeting that was convened by the Coalition Against the Pipeline and the Department of Public Service to hear concerns and to for the department to respond to questions that you have regarding the pipeline. So I'm Cindy Cook. I'm a facilitator. We'll do introductions in a little bit. We're going to have some opening remarks. And let me just check my notes here. So let me just run through the way the course of the evening will go. We'll have some opening remarks by coalition members and the commissioner of the Department of Public Service. We'll then open it up to questions and comments. I've been asked by a number of people to balance the wanting to ensure that all perspectives and all people that come here are heard with also just wanting to avoid having any one person or group dominate the airtime. Any questions or, yes?
So what if it turns out that there's only 10% of the people here in favor of the pipeline and 90% against? I assume you're not going to do a 50-50 balance.
I'm just a facilitator, but this is not designed as a referendum of any kind.
It's just, you said was you're going to balance it, but if there's really virtually nobody here in favor of the pipeline and other people want to speak against it or vice versa, I would assume you wouldn't be doing a 50-50 balance because that wouldn't really be balanced.
Right, just ensure that everybody has equally the same amount of airtime is what I was trying to get at. So the way we're going to proceed from here is Jane Palmer is going to make some comments, and then Bruno John, and then June Tierney from the who's the commissioner of the Department of Public Service. So over to, where's Jane?
Good evening, everyone. I'd like to thank the Department of Public Service, Ms. Tierney, for granting us this public forum. And congratulations on your new appointment.
Very kind, thank you.
I hope you find your new commission, your position as a commissioner of the Public Service Department, fulfilling and not too stressful. It must be a little strange to switch from a legal position supporting the Public Service Board to a head of a department. The day-to-day challenges, which used to be more or less, finding legal statutes to justify decisions made by others, to making decisions using your heart that others will now have to scramble to support. I want to start out this forum by pointing out that there has been a pretty significant misunderstanding between the public and the governor's administration. It's an understandable misunderstanding, though. The name of your branch of the administration is the Department of Public Service. Being human involves some extent of self-centeredness. And all of us tend to pay more attention when we hear our names in a title. So this is the Department of Public Service. That must mean it's a branch of government designed to serve me. How nice. This misunderstanding may also stem from the mission statement that is currently posted on the front page, second paragraph of the DPS website. And I see that's been passed out as well in one of the handouts. This is what it says. The mission of the PSD is to serve all citizens of Vermont through public advocacy, planning programs, and other actions that meet the public's need for least cost, environmentally sound, efficient, reliable, secure, sustainable, and safe energy, telecommunications and regulated utility systems in the state for the short and long term. That sounds pretty nice, doesn't it?
Yeah.
So it doesn't seem like we were being naive or optimistic when we assumed the Department of Public Service was there to serve the public. But that's not really what the department has been doing, is it?
No.
At least that is not what we have witnessed the department doing. I think it was in June of 2013, 6 months before the PSB decision to grant the Vermont Gas Pipeline Project a certificate of public good. There's that damn word again, public. That previous commissioner, Recchia, along with then Governor Shumlin, publicly came out in support of building the Vermont Fracked Gas Pipeline. At the time, we were still under the impression that the PSB would be the ones making the decision. All the evidence had not yet been submitted or evaluated. Scientific studies were popping up almost weekly about the harms from fracking and the impact methane has on our climate. But none of that mattered. It seemed to us that the DPS would take a stance on something, from deciding who should be allowed to intervene to whether or not the pipeline should be built. And with only slight variations, the PSB would issue an order doing essentially everything the DPS told them to do. This was not the way we pictured things would go. DPS was supposed to be working for us. The reality is, DPS cannot both be a proponent of a project and do the vetting of a project at the same time. At many points during the past 4 years, we thought Vermont Gas Pipeline Project was surely doomed. There were gigantic cost increases, safety violations, lack of oversight, shoddy oversight of... easement procurement and loss of markets. But still, this pipeline seems to be prevailing, even at this time of climate crisis, near doubling in construction and permitting costs and steep competition from low oil prices. Governor Shumlin stated in a radio interview just before he left office that the decision to build this fracked gas pipeline was totally based on policy. That was an interesting statement to hear, because we had suspected that fact all along. If this was the case, there was no reason for us to dedicate so much of our time, money, and energy toward getting the PSB to see the light and dump this boondoggle. Why did the legislature create the Act 174 Working Group to try to figure out ways for the public to more easily participate in the 248 process if the decisions are made by our governor and others in the administration? It seems like an attempt to placate the public rather than include them in this decision-making process. So, we're all hoping that with the changing of the guard, so to speak, that things will change in this part of our state government. I mean, we're really hoping. Truth is, we need you, Ms. Tierney, to listen to the people, to weigh the facts and sentiments of those who pay your salary, and to be brave. Do the right thing. Which is why I brought you this little gift. I hope you can keep it somewhere near where you can work, where you work, so you will often be reminded of those that are depending on you. It's Kermit the Frog, because it really isn't easy being green.
Hi. I'm Bruno John. I'm 14. I'm from Springfield. I'm a musician. I'm part of the green team at my school, which is an environmental advocacy group. I'm pretty concerned about this pipeline because this passion that I have, music, this pipeline is really one step closer to destroying that for me. And it's the hypocrisy of the situation and it's really offensive that my future is gambled by the pipeline being built to sort of fuel our humanity rather than the sort of the energy needs of our humanity rather than my life and passions. And I really hope that DPS can really help me along in this, in my life, to make sure that we can really make the right decisions and create alternative solutions so that my passions and life can be preserved. Yeah, thank you.
Okay, so next up is the Commissioner of the Department of Public Service and her frog.
With a frog in my voice. Thank you. Thank you very much. I really don't know where to begin. I am overwhelmed. Jane, I gave you a hug just now. It's been 4 years. Has it really? I haven't been able to do that in 4 years. It's a pleasure to do that now. I think one of the most remarkable things that happened to me after I was asked to take this position by the governor was when I had an email from Mary Martin. Yes, you. Will you stand up? Please. The email from Mary meant so much to me because it was, from my understanding of where the land lay, improbable that I would receive congratulations from you. It is one of the indices that gave me confidence to convene this forum this evening. It seemed to me that this was a good moment to not make assumptions about each other. Many of you know me, you think. Jane, I don't mean to quibble with you. I've not spent these years finding statutes to support things. I have spent these years doing my very best to serve in the capacity that I had. And as an attorney, one takes an oath to certain principles. And those principles have never been more important in our nation's life than at this moment. The idea that you owe duties of loyalty, that you owe it to yourself and to your family, to your fellow citizens, to be a person of integrity. I have always endeavored to do that. My first job, where is Mr. Bruno? Mr. Bruno, where are you? My first job was as a military officer, but my first love has been music. And so you and I have that in common. There's nobody more committed to a future where music can be played than me. My only regret is that I don't have as much time as you do, meaning left in my life to play. In any event, it has been my experience that there is so much more that connects us, that divides us. I see so many people here of good faith and who are seriously committed to the public life that is possible in Vermont, where we meet each other in a place like this. We tell each other hard truths. We assume the other person is listening. And we understand that things are complex. We don't always get what we want. But I have found in my own public life that the best policy comes when people are getting some of what they want, some of what they need. I'm not a magician, but I am a person of good faith. One of the delights of the new position, Jane, is that I am able to work with these people of good faith and integrity who are all part of the Department of Public Service. And if you'll indulge me, I'd like to take a moment to introduce them. I have with me tonight Jim Porter, who is our Director of Telecommunications. More importantly to me, I know him to be a man of good faith and great warmth, and he serves on the director's team in my department and helps me with tough decisions. Next to him is Jeff Commons, a man I've been privileged to know many, many years. He is our director, our acting director for public advocacy. He's the top lawyer in the agency. Next to Jeff, more or less, is Carol Flint, the wonderful person who leads the staff that takes every consumer complaint, that takes every public comment and takes them very seriously, and makes sure that people like me hear those comments and take them to heart. In the middle is Bill Jordan. He is our chief engineer. Bill works very long hours to make sure that the infrastructure in this state is well supervised and well run. Next to him is Ed McNamara, at this point an indispensable part of my team, in that Ed, for the last 6 weeks, has been serving as the deputy commissioner in our department, and also the individual to whom I have had to delegate a variety of decisions because my obligations as an attorney require that I not be substantively involved in matters that I was helping the board with, as you noted, Jane. So Ed has been making some of those decisions under the supervision of the governor. You will see Ed and I tonight passing off questions to each other. It's intended as a gesture of respect to those obligations that I have as an attorney, and also a gesture to you folks to make sure that there's somebody here tonight who is able to answer questions when I can't go there because of my prior occupation. Next to Ed is Tim Duggan. Many of you know Tim. He was one of the attorneys on the pipeline case. This is a young man with a very bright future. I know him to have a great deal of integrity and to put a lot of effort into sifting for the public good, though I do respect that there are different ways to understand what the public good is. Between Mary Martin and the Palmers, that's been impressed upon me. Next to Mr. Duggan is Louise Porter, a woman of equal capability and talent as an attorney. She too worked on the pipeline case and is here to help answer questions. Next to Ms. Porter is Mr. Wynn, who is a win for the department in the sense that Mr. Wynn was not at the department during the chief case, but rather has joined us more recently. His training is in finance. He helps us understand the rate impacts of things that we are trying to do. I assure you there is nobody more committed to the public interest when it comes to rates than Mr. Wynn. Next to Mr. Wynn is GC is our gas engineer. He is the individual who goes out in the field, inspects the complaints that comes in, is vigilant on your behalf. He calls balls and strikes. He's committed. I've known GC for over 15 years and have seen him less in the office, more in the field, because he's out there every day inspecting gas infrastructure to make sure that you folks are safe. And then last but not least is Ms. Drinkwine, Stacy Drinkwine, who is our administrative director, clerk of the works, without whom nothing is possible at the department, let me tell you, and has made me feel most welcome in my position. I apologize for the length of time it's taken to introduce these people, but I'm under the impression that in past public hearings and meetings, you've not been introduced to the full complement of people who work at the department. If there's one takeaway that I can get across tonight that is not inflammatory, but that helps you think about these issues differently, just as I am trying to think about them differently, it is that the department is not any one person. The department is not just me. It is not just a concept or a word in a statute. The department is Vermonters of goodwill and good faith who have every bit as much interest in getting this right as you do. And I'm very privileged to work with them. And I can assure you, every one of these people feels very privileged to be working for you. Thank you.
So at this point, I'd like to get a sense of how many people here would like to ask a question of the department or make a comment about the pipeline. Can you just get a show of hands? Okay, so embarrassingly enough, I had to pull out a calculator to do this, but if we have 2 hours, that's 120 minutes. My guess is that there will probably be roughly 60 people or so that want to speak. To ensure that in this limited amount of time, everybody has a chance to be heard, I ask that people keep their comments to a minute and a half. And I understand that there's some coalition members who came with particular questions and comments. And Mary, I'm wondering if you want to start out. Are you comfortable doing that?
Sure.
Okay, so over to Mary Martin.
You want me to stand?
You can do it however you're most comfortable. You can sit down, you can stand up. But just keep the microphone up so.
Okay. Yeah. All right. So I wanted to thank Commissioner Tierney for agreeing to a forum of civil and open process. Into my time. As you may have guessed by now, I'm adamantly opposed to this pipeline for many reasons. I'll leave climate change for others better versed. Most important to me is trust, truth, and safety. These three things matter when it comes to the future for our children and grandchildren. Please keep these three things in mind while I'll tell you just one of many occurrences in the construction of this fracked gas pipeline. There was an incident on October 7th in Hinesburg, St. George, and Williston. The fire departments had been warned that Vermont Gas would be gassing up a section of pipeline with the use of an odorant, mercaptan. If you aren't familiar with mercaptan, Chevron Phillips reports that mercaptan is flammable, acutely toxic when inhaled. To avoid release in the environment, if inhaled, remove victim to fresh air and call a poison center. Material may produce a serious, potentially fatal pneumonia. Sorry. When I read the Williston Observer about the department, I had been mentioned. You
conclude.
Yes. When I read in the Williston Observer that the fire department had been inundated with calls about the smell of gas, I was concerned. Williston fireman Morton said the blow-off of mercaptan was not what they were prepared for, though. We were aware that they were going to be doing some work there, but we were not aware of a blow-off. I don't know if it was a planned or unplanned release. We had no knowledge of a large blow-off or the risk of the work before the utility began the process. I called Vermont Gas and spoke to Beth Parrott. She assured me, and I quote, "At no time was there a release of any kind." She stuck to this story, just like on time and on budget. She repeated this to me in emails also. No release of any kind. The Public Service Board should have been fully aware of this incident, since they are the ones responsible for overseeing the safety of this project. They appeared clueless when I asked about the blow-off, though in their credit, they said they would look into it. Louise Porter later explained that Beth Parent had misspoken. Hinesburg, St. George, and Williston were all in the path of this release of highly flammable and dangerous mercaptan. The people doing the work were in St. George, not Williston. The parties responsible for this accident aren't even aware of the basic geography of the pipeline. Mercaptan is heavier than air. The location of the valve station is on low ground. There is a ridge between it and the town of Williston. The story I was told, and it took a lot of persistence and over a month and a half, just doesn't add up. So back to trust, truth, and safety. A score of 0 for 3. Commissioner Tierney, can you help change the score? Will you help to make it 3 for the people and 0 for a polluting fracked gas pipeline?
With the deepest respect, thank you, Mary. I know that was not easy for you. I will not do as you ask. What I will do is lead the department in the proper role that it has, which is to be a place you trust, which is to be a repository of information that you find reliable, you and other Vermonters, you who have a certain persuasion and other Vermonters who have a different persuasion. I think your government serves you best when it positions itself to serve you trust in a manner that is trustworthy, which means I can't be here tonight and tell you I'm going to make it one way or another. What I can do is tell you that this is a vigilant department. It has experts. I think GC knows I'm talking to him, right? I see Ms. Porter taking notes. She knows what's coming next. What comes next is, of course, an inquiry into the issue that you've raised. But that is all I can promise.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Great. So, Henry, I think you want to say something?
Hi, folks. My name's Henry. I know and like a bunch of y'all, and we've been working together for a while. And I think that's kind of my point in standing up here and asking a question. y'all are charged with rubber stamping or approving or being involved with this utility project going forward. There's utility projects like this all over the continent, all over the world. There's pipelines pulling all this gas material out of the ground and shipping it into international markets, which this pipeline is going to eventually connect to international markets, no matter what our comprehensive energy plan says about what we're going to do with our share of the gas. And, you know, there's explosive volatile fracked oil coming down the west shore of Lake Champlain in molasses cars and DOT 111s. Somebody approved that too, right? So I work with this volunteer group of people out here trying to figure out how to keep this volatile, explosive, human society ending material out of our economy. And if you're part of that volunteer effort, could you hold up this sign? Okay, so y'all issued a press release that this event was gonna happen tonight. I don't see anybody with the sign that says pro pipeline. All I see is no pipeline, okay? And so I don't understand why all of us volunteers have to keep on coming out here and facing off against you educated, salaried people year after year and getting nowhere. How are we supposed to feel? And I'm addressing this question to the new commissioner, because you are the new commissioner, and you know you shouldn't be visited with the sins of the fathers here, but how are we supposed to feel that we have to continue to come out here and try and oppose this thing that the biggest scientific consensus in history has said, we can't have this. We can't have this in our communities, we can't have this in our world, and y'all sit up there and get paid to continue to rubber stamp this project. Speak to us. Speak to us who have been doing this work.
Is it, do you prefer Henry?
My friends call me Hambone.
Hambone, is it? You might call me Baboon. I don't have many friends. I suspect that maybe because of the work I do, I have lost friends over this work. I miss those friends, but I can play music by myself if I have to, Mr. Bruno. It's the gift of being a solo guitarist. I can try to speak to you, Henry, or Ham. The question is, are we speaking the same language? It's an honest question. I heard what you said, that we're getting paid to rubber stamp things. I don't know a single person here who's rubber stamping. I know people here who are working very hard to conduct searching inquiries. What I can hear in your comment is that you're not persuaded of that, and I don't think I have it in my power to persuade you of that. What I can say is a genuinely searching process is open, it's not closed-minded. And you can be sure that my department will be open in its mind, in its heart, its doors. But that's all that I can promise you. My whole career, my whole life has been spent weighing things, listening to different perspectives, finding synthesis. I respect the fact that tonight when you raise signs, there is overwhelmingly a preponderance of people here who oppose this pipeline. It's very clear. I guess I would ask that somebody here perhaps tonight help me with a question. How do you go about determining what you believe to be the public's will, the public's view of something? Because I've been doing that for 17 years. I find it changes with every project I work on. I don't have a scientific way of finding out who supports one thing or another. Instead, I'm left with the realization that a special trust has been vested in me, especially in this job, by an individual who was elected to make those judgments. And so I appreciate that from your perspective, Hambone, that you're able to find your neighbors and people of good faith who share your view, and that you keep their company, and we are privileged to be in their company tonight. But as somebody who spent an entire career weighing information in search of the public good, I cannot concede that this is the only voice in our discussion. I don't know why other voices are not present, and quite frankly, I don't care. Tonight, it's about you. Thank you.
Okay, so Richard here promised that he would keep to the 90s.
Robert, I'm sorry, to the 92nd
rule. So.
All right, here goes. Robert Himes, Hinesburg Conservation Commission. I want to speak to a very specific aspect of this project. We went in, they went through our park. They're going through our park right now. The original plan, we just questioned from the start because they said they were not impacting wetlands. We were on the ground, we looked, they're going right through wetlands. And we went to DEC, said, hey, they're going through wetlands. Anybody looking at this? And they assured us that they had looked at it. It wasn't until I led a walk with Vermont Gas, their consultants, VHP, for them to actually acknowledge that they were going through wetlands. And we had DEC confirmation that they had reviewed this. So we decided to look at the other public parcel in Hinesburg. And sure enough, they were supposed to delineate wetlands. Clearly, they did not delineate wetlands. And it was not, and the state was nowhere to be found on this issue. Okay, so, and this is just one of the aspects, one of the technical aspects of this work. I think the takeaway is that this project was just way too big for Vermont Gas to manage and way too big for the state to regulate. And until you have a mechanism for the state to regulate, they should not be taking on projects like this. Thank you.
Thank you, Robert.
Well, I want to first say thank you to June Tierney for calling this meeting and for the members of the Department of Public Service, all of you being here to meet with us and listen to our concerns tonight. I wanted to try to answer the question about how we know about what the people in Vermont really stand for and what they want. Well, I've been at this work with Henry and others, Mary, all of my good friends. I've made some of my very best friends in my lifetime. In this effort. I got to know a lot of very, very dedicated and wonderful people. And I know them as people who are trying to get at the truth, trying to understand what is scientifically best, what is legally best, what is best for the people of Vermont. And I'm thinking about how leaders from several organizations, AARP, 350 Vermont, Conservation Law Foundation, Rising Tide, Just Power, BPIRG, and many other organizations and individuals have stood up and talked about this constantly for a time, and people have come from all over the state. And from what I understand, they really do know what the story is, and they listen to their neighbors, and they speak for their neighbors. So several hundred people represent, I believe, a whole lot of Vermonters, a whole lot of Vermonters. So I want to say, in conclusion, if I may, our beautiful state has set a responsible goal to conserve fuel and develop other energy sources so that we're 90% free of fossil fuels by 2050. So how does it possibly make sense to build this pipeline that is expected to have a useful life of 50 years to make it worthwhile? And I'm well aware that laying the pipeline extension to Middlebury is nearly complete. I still believe it was best for the Champlain Valley and for Vermont if gas never flows through it, and that is my hope.
Thanks very much. My name is Kevin Leverett, and I would like to point out that we came to respond to the fracked gas issues, but we're only a minority when we compare us to the balance of life on this planet. There are zillions of souls out there that have no voice, and they're going to be affected by any leaking fracked gas or the consequences of burning dirty fuel. So please, remember the rest of the of creation.
My name is Mari Portis. I'm a registered nurse. I live in Lincoln. I'm a board member of 350 Vermont and part of a political action committee in the Lincoln area. I had the good fortune today to be part of to witness a naturalization service for 26 people from 13 countries that became new Americans today. They became new Americans because they wanted to live in a country that had a participatory and representative democracy. So to your statement about, Commissioner, with due respect, about balance, of public opinion. I do believe that public opinion is on against the pipeline. But to that point, if public opinion is the only thing that you're balancing, and I don't think it is, how long would slavery have lasted? When would women have gotten the vote? So it's up to you to listen to us. This is the new revolution. Just like we responded to King George for his overreach, we're responding now to the overreach of corporations. It's time for our government representatives to listen to us and do the right thing because it is the right thing.
I'm feeling really honored to be able to be here with Vermonters. I've been feeling so blessed to live in Vermont in the last few months. And to see you beautiful people and all these beautiful people together being able to have a civil conversation. I'm sure you all went outside today. I was standing like this in Montpelier. This is a problem. We have got to take this seriously. I was thinking when I came in here, hey, this is a great showing. And then I thought, no, everybody in this state should be here today, to be here right now. We are losing our winter. You know, we've had like 2 weeks of cold Vermont winter. If this isn't enough to say, enough is enough with bringing this dirty fuel out of the ground, I don't know what is. When are we going to put people, the water, the earth, first, instead of corporations? We've got to stop. Fracked gas is making people sick, and it's proven. Our state doesn't allow fracked gas, and yet we are supporting this company to be piping it through our state, and no pipelines are completely safe. So I just ask that you guys, will you please take that into consideration this week. We are not just having one day of 50 degrees. It's a whole week in the middle of February. It's enough. So thank you for your consideration, and I hope that you take all of this into your hearts.
Hi, my name is Jesse. I'm a resident of Fletcher, Vermont, and I'm also a member of the select board there. So as one public servant to another, I certainly understand how hard it can be to sometimes get a sense of what the public will is on something. We deal with it all the time, and we live in a very small town, but even then it's hard to gauge sometimes what the public will is on something. And one rule of thumb that as a select board we've adopted is that one of the things we consider is we get as much opinion as we can, and then we have to consider of the options on the table of different proposals, what is inclusive or taking into consideration the most needs? What's considering the most people? And personally, you know, when I look at this pipeline, and I've been involved quite recently against it, but I'm not a professional activist by any means. I'd much rather be eating waffles and watching movies on Saturday morning. And you have to ask yourself, you know, what's abundant? You know, is it human infrastructure projects or the natural resources and landscape we have around us? And the thing is, you can replace an infrastructure project with another one. You can find other ways to bring in energy, create jobs, benefit the economy. But you're not going to replace the wetlands the way it was. And, you know, you're not going to... It was spoken to more eloquently by others, but I just want to say it loud and clear. The fracked gas that the Vermont Gas Pipeline is bringing in, even if you ignore the environmental damage within our own state, please consider that the Lubicon Cree Nation, where the gas is being fracked, has a demonstrated increased cancer rate due to the fracking that's happening there. Now, we can turn a blind eye to that and say we're for the environment and we're considering what's sustainable and environmentally sound for our people, but do we not consider ourselves part of the nation of all people? And I, for one, do not want to continue to support that.
Person here, and then I'm going to loop around so that we get some folks on the other side of the room, but everybody will have a chance. So,
I didn't want to speak because it's intimidating. My name is Katrina, and I'm not going to stand here and try to come up with intellectual reasonings why this pipeline is not okay. I'm going to speak from my heart for a moment. I'm a mother. I also love this earth, and I love this life, and what I want to say is that I'm actually in shock that we're having this conversation still in 2017, and that there's so much, I'm going to shake, I'm just going to be in my shake, that there's so much that we know, and I want to speak to all of your hearts and say that we have an opportunity in this state to be an example. We have an opportunity in this state to say that we are not going to put corporations first, we're going to put the environment first, we're going to put the people first. And we know this to be right. And I know that in your hearts, you know that too, that this is our earth, this is our responsibility. It's our stewardship that's going to make sure that this earth is here for our children. And so I'm just speaking from this place of saying that I'm surprised that we're even having this conversation here. I'm grateful we are, but I also want to say that we know what's right and we know that there's alternatives. And I just want to share from my heart that we can do something better here, and I am praying that this group can lead the way to do that.
Please.
Hi, my name's Lindsay Love. The gas that will go through this pipeline is being fracked on Indigenous land in Alberta. Today, people at Standing Rock were pulled off the land that they were protecting against the pipeline. I want to know what you think, Ms. Tierney, about BT banning fracked gas but allowing Native people to lose land, livelihood, fisheries, and hunting grounds to supply the gas that's going to go through that pipeline, as is happening in Alberta and other places.
Lindsay, I think you are one of the individuals who had a hand in organizing tonight. Am I right about that? I wonder if you'd join me in a round of applause. I appreciate that you are interested to know my particular view about the matters you just raised. I would submit to you very respectfully, my personal views are no more or no less consequent than any view in this room tonight. What I do here is I hold a public trust in Vermont, and I have to apply the law of Vermont. I have to apply the process that governs the law of Vermont. I have to do my best to weigh what you folks think about these things and what others think about these things. I heard the very eloquent mother who overcame her fear of speaking. I might add, I have that fear too, but I push myself because I like to think I have something to contribute to this discussion. What I think about fracked gas flowing through a pipeline as a commissioner is different from what I think about it as a person. I'm glad to explain it. I'm glad to give you that view. I'm glad to submit to your censure for holding that view. But it is the very thing that I put my life on the line for when I put a uniform on as a very young woman, and I will never apologize for that. The reason why I distinguish between the two is because the one is my private view as a person, and like every one of you, I have a right to my views. I have a right to my privacy. You folks have chosen to come here tonight and to share your views, and I respect that. I thank you for it too. I honor it. I did not come here tonight to share my personal views. They belong to me. My views as a commissioner are those that I hold as a matter of duty. I do my very best to meet that duty with integrity. And that duty is necessarily bound by the laws of this great state, Lindsay. You have representatives who represent you who write those laws. Among the things that they write in those laws is that people like me are supposed to apply them in good faith. I cannot tell you why our state permits fracked gas to be imported. All I can tell you is that is what our law provides. I know I've not answered your question to your satisfaction. I'm sorry that we have to have a moment like that tonight. I appreciate that you censor me for that. I hope at least you can grant that you know I'm speaking from a place of integrity and delivering that hard message to you. I too am intimidated, just as the mother at the other side of the room is. It's not hard, easy to stand in front of all of you and to speak from this place, but it's what I owe you.
Thank you. Hi, I'm Nancy Baker, and I've heard there's someone from the Conservation Law Foundation here tonight. I'm sorry, I was getting feedback, who will probably speak more eloquently to this. But over 2 years ago, they put a case before you regarding rates that has yet to be heard. And I'm reading your little blurb here that says that the Department of Public Service is there to meet the public's needs for the least cost, environmentally sound, reliable, all those other things, safe energy. And I'm wondering why the ratepayers are going to have to absorb this extraordinary amount of overcost for a pipeline, which is really a trunk line. It's not going to distribute a lot of gas to anybody in the state. People had their bills added to without even asking their permission to put together the SURF fund, the slush fund, that it was money taken out of people's pockets
I'm sorry, and that's money that should be accounted for. I know you said you have a great accountant, but I also think you need to listen. You need to listen to the case that was put before you over 2 years ago about the issue of rates. It's that's your responsibility. Not a private opinion, it's your responsibility. So thank you.
The department wants to respond.
Hi, good evening. Tim Duggan, and I'm an attorney with the department. And thank you for that question. We currently do have a rate case pending that it, I think it's about 1 year. It was filed last February, but your point is taken. What I want to say is that we take the amount that ratepayers will pay for the service they are provided extraordinarily seriously. And we have experts like Brian and others who spend way more time than I can fathom doing, frankly, looking through spreadsheets, looking through invoices, looking through every part of the company's books to ensure that what's being paid for is just and reasonable. So I wish I could speak more eloquently about it. It is a lengthy case, I grant you that. And we have spent a long time working on it. It's coming to the final stages right now, but it is still an open case. So I'll leave it at that. But I think I do want to assure you that the amount of any costs, be it an ordinary expense or a big capital project that is gonna be borne by ratepayers, is something that we look at extraordinarily seriously, and that we have great professional staff working on. So we probably spent more time on this particular case than usual because it is such a big project. And looking forward to, we've had the contribution of CLF in this case as well. It's been a robust look, and we anticipate it coming to a conclusion, in the next few months.
I'm Barry Bailey. I'm the energy coordinator for Salisbury, Vermont. I'm representing Salisbury Conservation Commission, and I'm representing this way, and I'm representing my grandchildren to the Department of Public Service. You state that your duty is to meet the public's need for many things, including environmentally sound and safe energy. Physics doesn't negotiate. Nature does not negotiate. Either we stop burning fossil fuels, and natural gas is a fossil fuel, or we continue its use and see major cities sink underwater. New York, Brussels, Mumbai, Calcutta, Bangkok, Shanghai, Beijing, Hong Kong, Tokyo, Dakar, Accra, Jeddah, Buenos Aires, San Diego, Los Angeles, Portland, Seattle, Baltimore, Miami, Washington, D.C., all of Florida, and two-thirds of New Jersey. Gone slowly underwater. If we continue to burn fossil fuels, we will experience unimaginable disruptions. If we think that the million refugees from Syria is overwhelming, just think of the millions upon millions of city climate refugees around the world. Business Insider reported this October, German, UK, and US researchers have ascertained we burn all the coal, oil, and natural resource in the ground. It will melt all the land ice, including our Antarctica. It'll rise sea level 216 feet. Climate change is already happening in Miami. They're already pumping seawater out of the city. If we don't recognize natural gas as a fossil fuel and cease its development, the climate will continue to change, the face of the planet changes that will last for thousands of years. If not now, then when? We only have one planet.
Yeah.
the risk of redundancy, I was going to underscore the salient points in a piece I read this week on the CLF website. Actually, I'm not really concerned about redundancy. So many hundreds of us have been bringing these issues to your attention over the years, but we don't seem to have been heard. So I would appreciate it if you would take the time to read or reread the entire CLF piece slowly and ask yourself whether this fossil fuel infrastructure at almost twice its original proposed cost, which has already taken endangered species, has effectively evicted Vermont families from their homes, has a frightening record of safety violations, and still brings no financial or environmental benefits, is still in the best interest of our state and, more importantly, our planet. While writing that last long sentence, I was reminded of the very first pipeline hearing that I attended over 4 years ago. It was at the Middlebury Municipal Gym, and the VGS spokesperson was asked, "Will the building of this project require eminent domain?" Eileen Simulardes replied that VGS did not expect that to be an issue. VGS had no experience with eminent domain. Wow. This pipeline is not turning out as expected, is it? Please release Vermont from Shumlin's folly. And I'm I have more, but I'm just going to give you that article and hope you'll...
No, we don't move to the back of the room. I know there are lots of folks here. We'll get you.
Hello, my name is Laura Simon. I'm from the White River Junction area, and you may remember me from your hallway. I've been a social worker and a teacher and activist for 40 years. Because my conscience tells me that's what I need to do. I'm going to share with you two facts and a little picture. As we know, we're in this field, the gas is temporarily cheap because of the limited infrastructure to distribute it. And as pipelines and international shipping terminals are built, there will be a gas surplus and the prices will go up. And this is from the source of oilprice.com. It's an industry publication. It says from $2.50 per millimeter BTU, it will go up to $4 in 2017. So it's not the cheap source. It's expanding in price. And it's also dirty. Methane is a powerful global warming pollutant. It traps 86 to 105 times more heat in the atmosphere over 20 years than does carbon dioxide. And the spills make it be even less of a feasible fuel source. So I'm just gonna share this picture with you. Blown up, it's a little blurry, but the community TV is going to have it on. It basically shows the leaks in the Boston area. So no one's gonna say it is safe. These are thousands of lines throughout Boston.
My name is Eric Esselstyn. I live in North Montpelier, and from time to time, I get involved in medical lighting. And one of the things that is so apparent in any kind of research or any kind of project, if you have a control group of people who aren't getting the new pill or the new diet, they're just going on the normal way. And then when something special is going on with nutrition or medicine, this group goes forward and you set an end date for the study, and you do periodic tests along the way. And it seems to me that the pipeline got started when very, very little was known about things like these leaks in Boston. People didn't know how to see methane before, and now we know that from wellhead through every pump, through distribution, all the way, there is just enormous leakage. That information didn't become known until after the pipeline was well underway. And from looking at study after study in medicine, if they discover halfway through, they will stop the medicine, or they will stop the whole project rather than go forward, which is continuing to damage a particular part of the study.
My name is Heidi Wilson, and I live in Plainfield, and I'm a music teacher and a singer. And I thought it might be fun to sing, but that's kind of really not what we're here for. I wanted to ask you all a question, and I'm wondering first, who's been a part of this group, the Public Service Board, or the Public Department of Public Service, the longest? Great. Maybe you can answer this question. I'm wondering, maybe you could tell us how, like, what can we as citizens do to bring an end to this pipeline project? From your perspective, what influence do we have, and how do we do that?
Thank you. Wasn't sure I was going to get to talk tonight. I have been at the Department of Public Service for going over 26 years. And as a lawyer, I have an interesting job because the green books, the statutes that are passed by, full of laws that are passed by your representatives, tell me that I'm supposed to represent the public of Vermont or the ratepayers of Vermont, for the state of Vermont. So I have hundreds of thousands of clients, and I wrestle daily with the question that is really, that I think is underlying yours, which is, you know, how do we determine the public interest? We have public hearings, we have meetings like this.
We have a vote.
And you have a vote, and that is an excellent point. You have a vote. What I try to do, my job, is to, as Ms. Tierney said, follow the laws as written, do my best in good faith and as a human being and as an attorney with a job, do my best to try to figure that out. And people, citizens, everyone in this room, I think, probably, has the ability to vote. That's how you tell me what to do. My direction, I cannot actually speak to hundreds of thousands of my clients to try to figure out positions to take. What I do is I follow the statutes as written. We take direction from people who are elected by my clients to do exactly that job of giving direction, of choosing commissioners and secretaries and so forth whose judgment they trust. And that's the person who my clients, the public, has trusted to do that. So how to affect outcomes? Be involved on the local level, be involved with energy committees. We've heard from some people tonight who are involved locally. Talk to your representatives. Elect people to office who reflect your views. And those people give direction to the government. We are not self-directing. We are guided by the will of the people as expressed at the ballot box and as expressed in statutes that are passed.
But not by us talking?
And by, I listen to everybody who talks to me. I listen and I take views into consideration, as does everyone at the department. We certainly do. And I will tell you that I don't know if there's any issue that I've confronted in the last 26 years on which all Vermonters would agree. There is always difference of opinion. And it is not feasible. I frankly do not know of another system other than the democratic process that we have for people to express their will and tell their government what they want it to do.
Thank you. And I want to re-ask Heidi's question, which I think was a fairly specific one, which is what can people in this room who are opposed to the pipeline do to stop? Do I have that right? Mm-hmm. And you spoke to sort of how you go through your process, your deliberative process, but this is a question for the department. What can those who are opposed to the this pipeline, what specific actions can they do to affect that outcome?
Thank you. So the short answer is the Public Service Board issued what's called a Certificate of Public Good. How long ago was this now? December 23rd, 2013? So at this point, what we're actually seeing is certificate has been granted. The only thing left is the Supreme Court, I believe, is actually still reviewing a condemnation. Is that?
One in Hinesburg.
So at this point, the permit's been issued. We had a discussion about that when we actually talked about the forum, of holding this forum, and it's unclear from a legal perspective. The department no longer has an advocacy role. We advocate in front of the Public Service Board. We would advocate in front of the Supreme Court. That's been done, and the decision has been made by the Public Service Board. So in terms of what can you do to actually stop the particular project, at this point, the process is essentially complete, and now what we're trying to do is figure out how do you move forward? How do we learn from the past process, and how do we... So essentially, to me, this forum is more a looking forward. How do we go forward on this? How do we take into...
Monkey wrench!
How do we take into consideration the issues, and what do we think about the next time a project comes up? And that's, there's a pipeline project, there's wind projects.
Next time is too late.
There's a lot of different projects out there, and instead we need to look at how the Section 248 process works, how we need to behave, how we need to take into account public input as well. I'm sorry that's not the answer anybody wanted to hear, but that's
Ed,
the answer.
I'm sorry, is that true for phase three as well?
There is no, my understanding is there's no, nothing in front of the Public Service Board at this point, except for the one pipeline project.
Yeah, why are we here?
We're here because a group of folks actually wanted to have this public forum, and we agreed to have the public forum.
So, y'all have a chance to comment, but there's a person has a microphone
to start. I'm Susan Abbott. I live in Marshfield. That I'm a little flummoxed for words after that statement I just heard. I'm one of the people who, for the last 4 years, has been asleep, thinking that, oh, we had an administration under Governor Shumlin who was watching out for the environment of Vermont. Big mistake. I was awakened by the Trump nightmare. I got out my pens and made my first picket sign in about 30 years over there tonight. And I want to thank the people who got us this forum, which is the people who sat in at the office and kind of forced the issue. And maybe going forward, that's what we're going to have to do more of, because it seems as though this is being considered a done deal. I was shocked, given Shumlin's environmental record, to see that he had been a proponent of a pipeline that's going to push fracked gas through our state. We can't do any better than that. And I'm really kind of confused about what I'm hearing tonight. It seems to me like, on what basis do you make decisions if it's not on content, if it's not on cost, if it's not on public feeling? I mean, really, it's very disingenuous to say that you don't know how the public feels about this. I don't see a room full of people supporting this pipeline tonight.
Right.
And I think, you know, we're just going to have to figure out where to go from here. But you can do more, I think, than you're doing. And I think you have the moral, you have a moral obligation to do more than you're doing. And I hope that you feel that within yourselves when you stand up for what's right in this situation, because it's very, very clear what the moral thing to do is here. Thank you.
Questions for the commissioner. You've been speaking about the two different persuasions a lot, and I'm wondering how you're treating the persuasions as if they are equally valid, when the scientific consensus is that one of the persuasions is literally going to cause the extinction of life on Earth. So how can we treat that as valid?
I forgot to mention earlier this evening that my academic training was in journalism. And there are two reasons why I studied journalism. One was because it would allow me to study everything that my college had to offer. I was a very curious person. I remained a curious person. I am curious, and I know I'm curious to many people. One of the tenets of journalism that I think have regrettably been neglected in our public discourse in recent time is the creation of false parity. You hear one side. I'm sorry, Mr. Paul Hamus, I don't mean to offend you. It's easy enough to under deadline, it is really easy to simply go looking for the other view. And then you feel, I'm really sorry, Mike. And then you feel like you have told the story as if it were truly captured by just two views. In your question, very respectfully, you are characterizing my views as being the two things that I'm balancing. I don't mean to be insolent. I don't think there's anybody who knows me who would recognize me as somebody who just balances two things. My mind is often characterized as being the sort of crazy marble cake thing, where I've got many, many things that come into play as I think about something and arrive at an opinion or a decision. So what I can say to you in good faith is, I don't take any one thing at face value, and I don't believe or engage in the creation of false parity. I respect your viewpoint that there, for you, is an absolute data point. That's a very important thing, and there are many people who agree with you. As the public policy person here, I factor many viewpoints in, and there are other things that have to be considered besides the view that you've espoused very articulately. I'm afraid I don't have more that I can say to your point. My crazy marble mind doesn't allow me to hold on to the point that long. The best I can do tonight is to convey to you that the process whereby we arrive at advocacy, as Mr. Commons tried to tell you, is a searching one. It's a product of reflection. And certainly for the folks here tonight who are wondering, how can you affect this process? The second takeaway that I would urge you to go home with is the questions that you folks are struggling with are much bigger than what is at stake in any one public service board case. It is.
That is not true.
I respect that. This is an example of false parity. I'm up here with a microphone. You folks don't have one. I don't want to abuse my prerogative with the microphone. I simply want to say that there are so many venues by which Americans can make their views known, so many venues by which Vermonters can make their views known. And when
why don't you make your views known?
Please tell me that.
Aren't you elected to be transparent?
To be clear, young man, lady, I'm sorry. That's my fear talking. No, I'm not elected. I'm appointed. I am appointed by a gentleman who is elected. And that was the point Mr. Commons was making. There are many places for you to make your views known. And ladies and gentlemen, if you disagree with that proposition, then this country is in much bigger trouble than we realize.
You just found out?
Forgive me, it's my role tonight to be the dunce. I see that you're wearing an Army sweatshirt.
Yeah.
Is that because you served?
No.
I did serve. I've known that for a very long time, that there are some people who put their lives on the line to bring the opportunity to vote to all of you. And if you've lost faith in that power, we have a bigger problem.
I wanted to intervene and say that there are a lot of opinions that people that want to express their opinions, talking over and hissing is going to cut into that time, and it's going to lead to a less rich dialogue than if you can respect that when somebody's speaking that they have the floor. And I'm seeing lots of hands. We're going to keep moving. The gentleman has a microphone here. So.
So I'm going to speak to all of you up here. I know what it's like to have a work opinion and a non-work opinion. I spent 19 months in Afghanistan having a work opinion and a non-work opinion, watching my friends die, watching other people who were, I was taught to hate, die, that my government made legal to do so. What I can tell you is having those two simultaneous opinions tore a hole in me, and I couldn't look myself in the eye. I literally couldn't. I would go to a mirror and I would try to look at myself, I couldn't. And until I started to actually ask the question of why, and I stopped saying, it's legal, so it's right, I stopped accepting that point of view before I could start looking myself in the eyes. So I don't think I'm going to change your mind here. I don't think we're going to have some miracle here tonight, but what I want to ask you is that 2 years from now or 3 years from now, and that picture of Boston that was shown to you is happening in Vermont, and the wetlands are being destroyed, and you're hearing about cancer here in Vermont. I want you to remember this moment right now, and I want you to look yourselves in the mirror and ask, do you think that it was really over at this moment? Was there something that none of you, was there anything out there that you could have done? Because I don't think that you're going to really do it.
From your statements that you served in Afghanistan
before? I was a civilian contractor supporting the Marine Corps and the Army.
Which is a regrettable development in our military management in this country, but nonetheless, sir, I thank you for your service.
Microphone, please.
So I'm going to speak to some of the voices that are in the room today, and my question at the end of this is, you had said that you don't care about why there aren't anyone here holding a sign that says, please put this pipeline in Vermont. So at the end of what I say, I'd love to hear your answer. There are golden wing warblers that are threatened, and they only go to Vermont in the northeast. There's a very small population of them, and this park where the pipeline is going through is one of their sweet spots to be and grow a family. And I'm just curious, to them and also to all of the creatures that live in the habitat of the ecosystem of a wetland, which is like really important for the health of the planet. They filter and provide a lot of habitat. The mycelium, this is a high water table, and it's ripping through the microbial community. There are in 1 teaspoon of soil many more creatures than there are in this town. And there's a responsibility when you talk about the public. The question I ask my students and what we're exploring as part of Vermont State Standards is this the Ecozoic era or the Anthrozoic era? We are part of a community that is far beyond humans, and there are many other creatures that actually provide regenerative community that we rely on. And this project is a microcosm of a macrocosm. It's actually very relevant. It's if you look at succession and you study it and you see a tiny rock with lichen growing on it, and then moss, and then lycopodium, and then you see trees. That is, the planet is like that. That's a small little version of the evolution of life on Earth, if you believe in Western science. And so this situation here in Vermont, this pipeline, is a little example of a very sick problem with our species, where we're feeling like it's all about us. And there's actually a debate going on in the scientific community they're trying to name this time period in geologic time, and should it be called the Anthrozoic era or the Ecozoic era? And I feel like you all have the opportunity to change that. And even though you said this might be a done deal because it's out of your jurisdiction, I'm going to challenge you to realize that these human systems are very young. They're just a speck of time, and they can change. You have the ability, you're a living part of the ecosystem. You could change your role, and entropic cascade is a concept where everything we do affects everything else. So there's so many creatures that are really excited for you all to be able to do what's right for the greater good of all beings on the planet. Thank you. And I'd love to hear your answer to that question about why does it not matter to you if this is a public forum, that there's no one in the room with a sign that says, please put this pipeline in Vermont?
I'm quite sure that I've expressed myself inartfully. I think in the moment when I said I don't care that there's anybody, that there's not anybody here who's for the pipeline, I was speaking from a place of integrity that was consonant with my feeling, which is that tonight is about the people who came to my office and who put themselves on the line to ask for this meeting. And that is why we're here tonight. And they've troubled themselves to bring out tonight people who have very similar views. The people who are for this pipeline are not here. I think, was it Hambone? Henry very correctly pointed out there was a press release that the folks who came to my office asked that we put out. And the response to that press release has been that people of good faith who oppose the pipeline are here tonight. If you look at the press release as an invitation to this forum, the invitation went out to everybody, but not everybody chose to come. And so what I honor tonight are the people who chose to come, and they are the people who have my ear tonight. They are the people I care about. I'm not here to discuss people who are not here and to speculate about what they think or feel. I'm here to give you my heart and my attention tonight, and I apologize if that is not adequate, but it is what I have to give.
The rest of the state just called, and they're with us.
One of the things I've enjoyed about you these 4 years is your humor.
Oh, no, I meant it.
Humor can be truthful, too. Excuse me, ma'am. I'm sorry.
Okay. I'm Dottie Kyle. I am president and managing officer of the Mad River Community Solar Farm in Waitsfield. We had an interesting time with the Public Service Board. We were issued a certificate of public good, and then all of a sudden they told us, you can't build there because it's wetlands. And we couldn't build there. We had to find a different spot, which we did. Now, my question is, if this is essentially a done deal, why are they building through wetlands if a community solar farm couldn't put a couple of posts into the ground where it's damp?
So who's in the department to speak about this thing?
So I can't really speak exactly in tune with the wetlands. It's an agency and natural resources issue. I'm not trying to, I'm not a wetland scientist. I do know, however, that there's wetland mitigation rules that happen. I don't know your specific solar project. I do know that I've seen this with electric transmission lines. I've worked on a fair number of those. I've worked on other projects as well. Haven't been involved with the pipeline up until folks showed up in the hallway a couple weeks ago. But there are mitigation rules that allow somebody to build through a wetland as long as they mitigate other wetlands. It's what happens with electric It happens in a lot of different situations. And I'd love to follow up afterwards and find out your specific project and why that was. I hadn't heard about that, so I'd love to follow up.
Thank you.
Thanks. My name is Sam. I've only been here about a month, but I came here as a refugee from southern New Hampshire. Where, in the end, we stopped the NED pipeline. So I'd love to help a bit here. And the first piece of advice I'd give you is you're not going to get anywhere from talking to these people. No. The only thing that will work is to take away the money from the people who want to do this. You have to persuade all the potential customers that this is not what they want to do. If you can do that, you'll stop it. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Rachel Smoker, and I live in Hinesburg. And when I found out that the pipeline was coming through our public park, I stepped into this fray after people had been fighting it already for 3 years or so. I'm a climate activist. I've been a climate activist for over a decade, and I'm mostly, you know, very scared when I walk out the door in the middle of February and find that it's 60 degrees and there are bluebirds flying around. I think that's pretty frightening. But what is actually more frightening to me about this pipeline project is what I have learned about the construction and the lack of oversight. The Department of Public Service is supposed to oversee the safe construction of this pipeline. Yet, there was a notice of probable violation that came across on the 16th of August. When I went back and looked through that, it turned out it was based on observations that the inspector had made in June of 2016. He noticed some things were out of line. Eventually, the notice of probable violation came in August. And then the Department of Public Service granted an extension. And then they granted another extension. And then they granted a third extension. And construction continued. They never addressed the probable violation. They never addressed the problems with the construction, which were very serious problems. Things like, we don't have any written specifications. We don't have any electrical expert on site. These are serious problems with that leave us now. Okay, construction continued from June through November. Okay, we're done. And guess what? Now we have a memorandum of understanding between the Department of Public Service and the Vermont Gas Systems saying we made some compromises and we've come to an agreement. And in the future, we'll try to do a better job. What I would like you to do is go back and dig up everything that you buried in the ground from June of last year through November and redo it all according to the minimum federal specifications for safe construction. Okay? It's not okay with me to just ignore and say it's a done deal and it's all done. It was not done properly, and I think you know that. And I would like to, for each of you to look into your hearts and ask yourself, if you had a family living right on the pipeline with an easement right in your yard and children there, would you be comfortable knowing what you know about the construction of this pipeline? I have dug and dug and dug through what I can find. I have filed public records requests, waited weeks and weeks for tiny little dribbling bits of information, which indicates to me that either the records were kept, the oversight wasn't done, or there's something being withheld. Okay, those are the only two logical possibilities. You either didn't do the oversight and the inspections, or you're withholding information from the public records requests. Do you honestly feel okay to have your children living on this pipeline?
Hi, Rachel. My name is Bill Jordan. I'm the director of engineering at the department, and I'll respond to your comment. the notice of probable violation that we issued in last summer.
The microphone?
Yes. The notice of probable violation that we issued last summer was for electrical safety for the workers working on the pipeline that wasn't yet in the ground. And it was not related to issues or integrity of the pipeline once in the ground. The incidents that we noted in the notice of probable violation occurred in June of 2016, and we were working with Vermont Gas daily. We had two inspectors on site nearly every day, and as soon as they found something, the issues we noticed in the notice of probable violation, we brought it to their attention and worked with them. In parallel, we were drafting what we call a compliance action for the issues that we did find, and so the extensions that we granted were for negotiations for the NOPV. In the field, we were working with Vermont Gas to bring to their attention what we found and to try to correct it. The issues in the NOPV, I want to stress, were not related to the integrity of the pipeline in the ground. It was more the induced voltage on the pipeline that was up on the supports before it went in the ground that could be a hazard to a worker that was working in that area. And that induced voltage was from the nearby transmission lines. So I just wanted to clear that up.
I think there was also a question of whether you'd be comfortable with your family living near the pipeline.
Yes, I would.
I'm wondering if the rules could be suspended so that Rachel could, there could be a dialogue maybe?
Do you want to ask a short call?
Just 10 seconds.
First of all, induced voltage is a leading cause of pipeline corrosion and a cause of pipeline explosions and accidents. It's not just a safety problem for the workers, so it is relevant to the integrity of the pipeline. Second of all, that was only one of the notices of probable violation. There was one earlier, and that was relative to weldings and coatings. I've gone through every record I've possibly been able to get my hands on. Weldings, coatings, electrical safety, failure to bury the pipeline properly. There's the issue of the mercaptan. We can make a long, long list of issues that have come up. We, the public, have a very hard time finding the right information to know, but I think it's ingenuous to stand up there and say that the problem with electric and induced current has nothing to do with the integrity. And let's face it, the prior notice of probable violation, those problems were never addressed either. They were left pending through construction.
Thank you for clarifying that. I should have been more clear. There are two different issues. There's cathodic protection, which is the term used for protecting the pipeline once it's in the ground. And there's also, when you're near a power line, you need to do something called AC mitigation, because you do have induced voltage on the pipeline once it's in the ground. We were not citing them for the AC mitigation. We inspected that and didn't find violations with respect to the AC mitigation. We did find violations with respect to the worker safety, the electrical safety of the workers in the right-of-way. And so we did look at the AC mitigation for the pipeline once it's put in the ground.
So as I'm walking along here, I want to get a sense of the group and whether it would be helpful to take a short break after this next question, or do you want to keep going and have people just cycle out if you want to get use restrooms? What's your pleasure? Keep going. Okay. All right. And I hope you'll understand if any of the panelists need to step out to use a restroom, please don't take that to be anything other than just they're human as well as all of us. Thanks.
I'm Deb Lowry from East Dallas. This question is for the engineers as well. Yesterday, Duke University published a new study in the Journal of Environmental Science and Technology. And they did the study because they saw that states do not have a standardized way of reporting pipeline problems and spills. And what they found was that in four states, only four states, over 10 years, there were more than 6,600 spills. So I'm asking you, what do you think of this? How if we must have these things, how can they be so shitty? And have you ever been in a situation where you saw something and you thought to yourself, I have a shadow of doubt, and you're in a unique position to be a whistleblower, and I just don't understand how this can be such a shoddy operation?
Hi, I'm Miguel Andrew Harris. I was a former student actually here not too long ago. I'm concerned with this pipeline due to the fact that I'm one of the next to coming to this great nation of ours, right? It just seems odd to me that you would just kind of pass off us, just like me as a human being, I'm just like kind of appalled by the fact that you would just kind of cast us aside and not even consider the fact that there's people here who are going to be living past your lifespan and not just like, I don't know, it seems odd to me that you would just say, yeah, let's spend another 50 years doing something that we know is wrong rather than go to an alternative fact that we know is able to be done considering Burlington, which is a 100% all natural fuel. That's all I have to say.
I'm a Cree Lilac from Shelburne. Speaking of the future, I wanted to just ask a question real quick about the Comprehensive Energy Plan. And it's my understanding the Department of Public Service has a new Comprehensive Energy Plan that's, you know, it's written every 5 years. The last one was completed mid-December 2016. And from my reading, I see, at least in several places, that it is a priority for the state of Vermont to connect with the federal gas pipeline. So when I read about the Attorney General of Massachusetts, who says that Kinder Morgan is not going to be putting their gas pipeline through Massachusetts, they may be looking to Vermont. So I would like to just get a sense of what the future is going to look like in Vermont, and with the Comprehensive Energy Plan that says it's a priority to connect with the federal pipeline, what can we all expect in our future?
Thanks. So, as you noted, we do update the Comprehensive Energy Plan at least every 6 years, last time December 2016. And there's a short section on natural gas. There's the vast majority of it is looking at total energy, transportation, thermal efficiency, and renewables. There's a small section towards the end, which is petroleum products, basically oil, gasoline, and then also talks about natural gas pipelines. I reviewed that particular section on natural gas a couple days ago, and there is a piece in there, you're correct, about potentially connecting to, it would probably be through New York or something along those lines. And this is not, when I say it's a, this is what we are going to do. Comprehensive Energy Plan is looking at different options. This is the 90% renewable by 2050 for all sectors, electric, transportation, and thermal. So natural gas is considered one option of fuel on a going forward basis. It's not saying this is under the Comprehensive Energy Plan. Sorry, being specific here.
I didn't realize I said it out loud.
So in terms of what can we expect, it's a planning tool, we'll look at it. There's already natural gas in the state. It, from a planning perspective, you have to think, how is this going to fit in with the increased renewables that the plan is trying to get at? How does this work towards towards the 90% by 2050 renewable goal? And part of me was looking at that and like, why is it 90% by 2050? Why isn't it 100%? And I think part of it is simply the fact that we already have the infrastructure in place. We already have
a longer-term plan, recognizing that natural gas throughout the country, people are planning for that. I'm not saying that's a good thing, I'm just saying that's how it's been planned. So in our plan, what we're looking at is to what extent natural gas is a component in Vermont. I can't stand up here right now and say there's no further, we will never ever allow any public service board will never permit another gas pipeline. Natural gas should be a relatively small component of total energy going forward. That's, to me, a takeaway from the Comprehensive Energy Plan. It does not, however, say that there's no, it's not a component at all. I don't know if that answers.
My point was, it's disturbing to me that it's a priority for the state to connect with the federal gas pipeline that I believe takes us in the wrong direction.
Ms. Cook, I hope we're not violating the rules of the forum tonight in proceeding in this manner, but I think Ms. Lipelak, is it, has brought out an issue that I think is of central interest to the people here tonight, and it is also one where I have a It is an issue that is of equal interest to me in terms of a message that my colleagues here tonight would like to get across to you folks. Your specific question was, what can we expect? And you've heard Mr. McNamara's answer. Another answer is, I imagine we can expect that all of you will be involved, and that all of you will be involved in the future iterations of the Comprehensive Energy Plan, and that you will understand that that involvement is not an act of futility. That involvement is the way in which the viewpoints that you have very strongly expressed tonight make their ways into the planning process. Just to underscore the point for you, the pipeline that brought us here tonight, it is the product of a plan. It is the product of a plan that was designed many years ago, at a time when we were not thinking the way we do today about the need for energy transformation. Planning has a certain lag built into it. We try our best today to envision what is needed tomorrow. And as the young man back there who was recently at Montpelier High very articulately put it, you know, how dare we? That's what we call in our field a question of intergenerational equity. I do that sort of thing with the greatest of trepidation because I have people like you in mind all the time. This is not by way of excuse, it's just a point that I would ask you to consider. When I was your age, there were people making those plans that brought the pipeline here today. This is a baton that we pass on from generation to generation. I am terribly sorry if our generation is failing yours. We are doing our very best. You must allow. I'm not saying we're doing well. I'm saying we are doing our very best. And I hear many of you tonight saying we could be doing better. You're being very clear about that. But here is my ask of you. Please do it.
We will.
Please be involved.
We are. We will.
Please do something more than coming to my office and occupying the halls, because I think you know by now that we're interested in engagement. You will get the engagement. But what you need is involvement that can actually be reflective of what it is you seek. And that involvement means learning about these plans, learning how to involve yourself in creating those plans, learning about your legislators, learning who is voting which way, involving yourself in town committees, in your energy committees. Our towns do have those things here in Vermont. That is where you need to make your presence felt as well. I am being cut off. My apologies.
Hi. I would just like to
talk about information. I think one of the things that we've heard several times from the panel tonight is that you don't have a good way to discern what the public will is. And I'd like to disagree with that. I'd like to disagree with it first because as far as I know, the Department of Public Service has done no empirical research about public priorities for energy. You could survey and distinct. You could do polling. You could actually ask people what their priorities are. I have heard Jeff Commons, who I think has, you know, really has the public's interest at heart, but I've heard him say that he's been around the state and talked to people, and people want two things. They want cheap energy and they want reliable energy. Other states have already added clean energy to the mix on the basis of surveys and polling. I encourage you to ask people because I think you might find that in Vermont, particularly among the 50 states, people balance the first two priorities with clean energy as well. Secondly, the market would tell you. As you know, I sat through much of the rate case because I'd like to say that I think there are a lot of people in this room who are engaged, who do show up, who do the research. And I think it's actually, frankly, quite patronizing to suggest that people are only advocates. And if you all know that professionalism requires doing all of it, somebody pushing the envelope to draw attention and somebody doing the research at the other end, somebody litigating, somebody working on influencers and policymakers. We can't stop and do one thing because that's the best, seemingly the best way to get something done. We have to do all of it. But I'd like to point out that the Comprehensive Energy Plan is a policy. It is not legislated. The fact that it has to be done is. And this, I believe, June and everybody else up on that panel, that's where your role comes in. Because I haven't heard Phil Scott say he's for more expansion of pipelines. I haven't heard him say he supports this pipeline no matter what, whether it's safe or not. And so I encourage you, if you really believe that's true, then you have to listen to the people who do show up. Only, as far as I know, there are only two comments at your hearings for the Comprehensive Energy Plan in favor of further gas pipeline expansion, yet you are expanding. So if you need empirical data, then you need to go out and find it. And let me just say one last thing, which is that if you need empirical data, look at the market. I watched the rate case. I did not see your department question or push Vermont Gas on how many customers they have in Middlebury. In fact, Eileen Similardi's was very good at avoiding that question, and your lawyers didn't follow up. That's not to say your lawyers are bad, but to say that when you do things like give extensions for the integrated resource plan, so that you can't tell everybody in this room what Vermont Gas's plans are, because you've given them two extensions. I believe we're up to 18 months now. You have given, changed the deadline for the FERC annual report so that they're not due until April. The fiscal year ended on September 30th. If you had that information, you would have been more able to verify and audit the costs. I can tell you that because I looked at 2016. So many things that your expert witnesses said were true, but they didn't know why. They had the information they had, but they didn't have the information from 3 years ago or the information they needed now that they should have had in order to do the job that they should be doing to make sure that ratepayers are not paying an extra penny for the pipeline than you are asking them to. That's an economic issue. I urge you, if you truly believe that the way you're going to do your job better is to have information, to stop playing into Vermont Gas's and other utilities' hands and get that information. We deserve it, and you deserve it.
My name is Urban Eisenberg, and I wanted to, for those of you here who have done military service, I did want to thank you for that. And for those of you who have done service to this nation, to this world, in other ways, and are going out on the line and giving service every day, I want to thank you too. And I don't think we should be demeaning anybody's service and deciding that some service is higher than others. Now, the little bit of service I'm doing, which I'm not asking for any congratulations on, is my grad school research. And there's a lot of things I learned about research. There's two basic tenets to research. One is look at the source. The other is look at the date. If you look at the date, you can get the most up-to-date research. I know that, that there are usually many sides to the same subject, but if you look back 50 years, you're going to find even more. So let's look at the recent literature, let's look at the recent research, and let's look at who is funding it. Now, a couple of recent points here are that all leading climate scientists are saying that it's going to be too late if we wait even to the 2050 date. And on top of that, there's a lot of new research out there, and I haven't heard of any new research to the contrary, saying that natural gas is, if not as, almost as harmful from a carbon emission standpoint as coal, with 80 to 100 times the amount of effect. We're talking about leakages at the site of drilling, and we're talking about on both ends. Now, I would challenge you, or ask you, here's my question. Do you have any one shred of research that wasn't funded by a major corporation that actually suggests that we're not in a burning building right now? We're just adding more fuel to this fire and saying, well, we'll throw a little bit more water on. See, we're putting a little bit of water on this, and in 50 years, we'll have a little bit more water. It is too late to be falling behind, thinking about policy and worrying about all these slow processes. We need to put the fire out. And I see a room full of people here, and I recognize most of these faces as people who have been on the front lines fighting in many ways. And please don't disrespect their service, and please give me one example or recent study that shows the contrary of what I'm saying. And by recent, I mean the last 5 years.
The department is sort of conferring as to who wants to respond to that. I just want to understand it, which is, in your deliberations, have you been? Do you have evidence that climate change is not a real and present
danger?
That's not what I asked.
No, the natural gas is at all a valid mandate to our climate change issue. We're just going to take it as a given that, considering all our Republican candidates for governor actually admitted that climate change exists and is a problem. But does natural gas a legitimate mandate? And do you do your research for a reason?
Thank you.
So at least in my mind, that is actually a policy question in terms of, yes, it contributes to climate change. Natural gas does. The same way that gasoline, the same way that fuel oil does, the same way a lot of other factors do. The question is, how quickly, how fast do you do that? Do you ban all cars? To me, it's a policy choice. It's not a research choice. It becomes, what is the appropriate phase out over time, and what's the time scale of dealing with it? And this is something that when we looked at a gas pipeline case, what we were trying to balance is the affordability aspect for some of the for some particular customers, including some of the large industrial customers. We're looking at also over a long time period, how do you actually phase out? Basically, the only answer I can really give you is that there is no specific study out there at all that says natural gas is or is not an appropriate band-aid. That becomes a policy choice. Yes, it's climate change is an issue. We all accept that. We all move forward. It's how you address natural gas in your fuel mix the same way you address every other fossil fuel that's in there.
So you're looking at policy, not at research. That's disgusting.
My name is Jeffrey Gardner. I live in Bradford. Until about a year and a half ago, I lived in West Fairley, where I was on both the planning board and the planning commission. I don't think it's a matter of phasing out. In this case, it's a matter of phasing in. And I think there are huge questions of integrity that come up here. We have a bunch of lawyers, accountants. We do have an engineer. That's getting close. Where are the environmental two? Where are the environmental scientists? The greatest impact of these projects is an environmental impact of climate change. It should go to people who are expert in that first for the first permit. If it crosses that barrier, which none of these projects would, then you can go on to what really is your business, which is rate setting and rate regulation. How a rate regulatory board gets to make the most momentous environmental decision is absolutely beyond me. Yeah. How do you justify that? Yeah. Well, there's something else about that that also goes to integrity. June, this isn't a matter of decisions that people made 50 years ago about planning. It's about decisions that three people, with your advice, made between June of 2013 and December 23rd of 2013. Mm-hmm. A man who I don't know whether he works for DPS any longer or not came to the board and testified for DPS. His name was TJ Kaur. Was he an environmentalist? No. Was he a scientist? No. He was an economic utilities analyst. And he brought to the board research, not policy, research by Richard Howard, his first paper, the first paper that said, in fact, natural gas, methane, leaks like mad from the wellhead, actually from the drill point, all the way through to the consumer. And he even said a number on that. He said it leaks at a rate of 3.8% on average for every well. I gotta say more. This is important stuff. When TJ Kaur presented this, and he was straight about it, he was honest about it, he said, oh, here's the EPA, and they're saying it's way less than that. Well, the EPA information, both about methane as a driver of climate change and about how much actually leaks, was just about 13 years behind. They were way behind. In that period from June to December, the EPA's own administrators said, we got to do this research over again. Something is not right here. In fact, the research that it had been based on was all done using facts and figures that came from where? From industry. Not too good. By April of 2014, Howard had his second paper. All the numbers went up, because by then he could use the IPCC's numbers about how much of a driver of methane, what driver of climate change methane was. Where was TJ Kaur? Where was Chris Recchia? They followed the advice, or they were following the research in 2013 in June. Where were they in 2014 in April? Did they come back? No. Why? My sense is the certificate of public good was issued. That's all we needed. We put it against the EPA's pretty lousy research at that point, and we decided, oh, we can't really say whether this is a problem or not, because there are two different, this will seem familiar to you, methodologies involved. Well, one methodology was to do research, and the other methodology was to talk to industry. I think what you people really have to take to heart is this. You're public officials, all of you, and that means you've got to follow the Constitution. And the Constitution says, among other things, that among your first duties is to protect, in every way you can, the public welfare. To add to climate change the way you do, and all of these other problems of health and safety and expense and so on, and getting involved in people's property and dealing with a corporation that lies consistently, you are not protecting people's welfare. The mission statement that Jane read earlier lays out a whole bunch of things as if they were equal. and. A big part of your job is to decide which of those things is most important. Is it saving money for ratepayers? That's not the whole public. Ratepayers don't exhaust the public interest. Is it protecting the profits of VGS or any other corporation that comes to you? I don't think so. Public interest first, public welfare first. And in fact, the ratepayers and the corporate executives are part of the public whose interests you have to protect. And if you add the way you have already to climate change, you're making trouble and putting everyone in jeopardy, and you also have established a precedent to do more of the same terrible thing. Think about it.
Yes!
As quickly as I can. And the first one is, I think you know all the information people are sharing with you about the deleterious effects on the climate. I think you know the cost-benefit ratios. I think you know a lot of the science. In the end, it's not about any of that. In the end, this is a moral issue. We cannot continue, as everybody's been saying in one way or another tonight, to burn more fossil fuel to create more fossil fuel infrastructure that our kids are going to have to pay the price for. I want to say something else about this, though. We've also talked a little bit about public service and your role. I spent 29 years in state government. I served three governors. I was commissioner of two departments and the deputy secretary of one. I know exactly what you go through, Commissioner, in your deliberations and your decision making. I know exactly what it's like to make a very difficult decision when both sides are at you about it. At some point, it becomes a moral choice for everybody. There are people leaving the Trump administration today because they cannot go along with what's being done. I'm not suggesting you do that. My point is that there's a lot of, I bet you there's a lot of people in the room who would agree with me that we are very cynical about the process that we've gone through over the past 4 years or so. Having been in government as long as I have, had sat in rooms with the governors, various governors, I know the role that politics plays in decision making. And I know that very good people, which I assume every single one of you is, I know how you can be compromised by those politics. And that's where you have to push back. Because I believe that this gas pipeline was a done deal back in 2012. Done deal. Signed, sealed, delivered. And the only people that were pushing it, obviously, were the people who were going to make a lot of money from it, Gas Metro and Vermont Gas. Yeah. Done deal. And so we're very cynical. And my closing point is, we don't want to be cynical. We want to believe that you are, in fact, acting in our best interest. We want to believe that you are taking into consideration what is really in the public good, and it's not more fossil fuels. So I give you credit, Commissioner, for having this meeting tonight. It's a very difficult thing to do. I've done it many times. But I got to say, going forward, I think it was Mr. McNamara, is that your name? He mentioned going forward. And then there's a question about what's going to happen next. I think we expect forthright, honest, open, transparent government from all of you that we can rely on to do the right thing.
Passion, but if you want your fellow people to be heard, please be as succinct as you can be. Thanks.
Hi, I'm reading this for Terrence Cuneo. He couldn't be here tonight. I am a landowner and now former resident of Williston, whose family was, to put it very mildly, deeply affected by this pipeline. I'd like to say three things briefly. First, if there's anyone present who is likely to be directly affected by this pipeline, say, because it's likely to run through your property, I'd be happy to talk to you to with him or her. You can find my contact information easily on the UVM website. Second, the VGS pipeline is a disaster in nearly every respect. Families such as ours were forced to have a pipeline run through our property against our will. Anyone who cares about property rights and is alarmed by the willingness of the state of Vermont to trample on them so that huge fossil fuel companies can profit will understand with the firmest resolve against this pipeline. Third, it is of the utmost importance that you educate yourselves about pipelines, their safety, what sort of gas they transport, and the companies behind them. Gas companies present fracked gas as a safe and clean alternative to oil. We have overwhelming empirical evidence that this is just false, and it is not an innocuous falsehood. Fracked gas is a nightmare for our world. We now have much better energy alternatives that do not require families to have their property seized and do not release enormous amounts of greenhouse gases into the atmosphere. Thanks. I'm Terrence Cuneo.
You're asking for a copy of this?
Yep.
So I'm going to come back up here, but I promise folks back here.
Thank you so much. Hi, my name is Hannah Morgan from Plainfield, Vermont, and thank you for the opportunity to speak tonight. I work locally for an ambulance service as an EMT, and so I work for a fire department and also am a volunteer on a local fast squad in Plainfield. And so because of that experience, I know firsthand that as a state, we are absolutely not prepared at all for the sort of emergency that could happen, a disaster that could happen from a pipeline such as this. And I think that it's not a question of if it will happen, but when. And so I'm very concerned about the lack of safety taken into consideration around this project and what it will mean for the people who will be directly impacted when that will happen, and the fact that there aren't people prepared to deal with the aftermath of that. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Ryan Gillard, and yes, thank you all for the opportunity to speak. Just looking through this timeline, I couldn't help but think about some issues of trust and wondering really what is it in Vermont Gas that you as the department trust over the people. And if we were to draw some simple analogy, like we the people are paying to have a construction project done, and you all are helping us, maybe you're the general contractor and helping negotiate prices, and we're paying money, and there's someone who comes and says, we want to do all the plumbing for you, and we say, okay, we sign a contract, and we don't really want the, did I just lose my tongue? We don't really want the plumbing because we want a composting toilet anyways, but you guys say, no, well, it's policy, it goes along with the comprehensive energy plan, and then all of a sudden, millions of dollars later, after we've signed the, after you guys have signed the contract with the plumbing company, you say, well, we're still gonna push through the project. And this is gonna cost us, and I'm just not sure, not sure why you trust Vermont Gas, that they're doing what's in the best interest for the people. And there's a lot of money behind the people that work for Vermont Gas. And if you look around this room, these people have been working really hard for a number of years.
Out of this coffee can.
Yeah, out of the coffee can. And there's not a lot of money behind us. And the intentions of the people in here are not just to be, you know, cave people like Shumlin said, but are to fight up and stand for real change against corporations. And so I just say, you know, what matters is the public interest really in this and not corporate interests. And before I get totally cut off here, I just have two last pictures that I want you to pass down the line. You can take one. And you can take one. And so you don't need to spend too much time looking at them, but they're relevant pictures. The one coming this way is a picture of the pipeline in Hinesburg. And that's supposed to be 36 inches deep. buried 36 inches deep, I just say, ask yourself as a department, are they doing their job? Does that look like 36 inches deep? The second picture is a really devastating picture, and it's from Pakistan, and it looks like a pipeline trench, and it's not. It's a trench for mass graves following the heat wave last summer in Pakistan, as a result of climate change. So I would just ask the department to really think about what is in the public interest and what's in the corporate interest, and what is it your responsibility to protect?
Yes.
Hi, my name is Andrea Stefani. I'm from Plainfield, and something alarmed me when the commissioner spoke in the beginning and said that, and you got a lot of boos for this, but nobody explained. You said that your private opinion is not necessarily what you do at work. And I just want to point out that ultimately all decisions are based on emotions, on emotional priorities. For us all, it is really important. That's why we are here, instead of being at home doing all kinds of million other things which are waiting for us. For us all, it's important, and many more and more people get here represented, that the environment gets protected, that the environment comes. And I would like to point out that when we struggle of, well, how could the future be, and what will be next, and what should have been done differently, Sweden, the whole country, has decided 12 years ago already, written out an article which I found in the library of Montpelier, California Library, the Yes newspaper, that the whole country by 2020 will be totally fossil free. From 12 years ago, they invested, government and local and nationwide, everything they could into the direction of renewable energy only, the best all the time. And I have, as a teacher, hope that everybody learns constantly, that also you don't have to look and say, well, you young people will take over and do it maybe better. I have hope, and I believe that if you find something good, you will go for it. So if you see in all of our comments today, really positive and future-pointing, beautiful visions and concerns about where it might go wrong, you will rather go in the progressive and the positive direction, and you will be spontaneous and say, yes, this sounds right. We should do whatever we can to pull an emergency brake on something which is wrong, which we decided maybe because of lack of information, maybe because of too much push from the wrong direction, we decided it a few years ago wrongly. So whatever can be done to correct mistakes has to be done. We can't just let a train go down the wrong path. And I know you have more power than me or any single person here probably. So that's why we are here, because we want to appeal to your power and to your help. But also you have grandchildren, and you must also have concerns about the future.
Hi, my name is Alexandra Thayer. I'm a recovered lawyer. I make a lot of people happy when I say that. I've been a prosecutor. I've been a public defender. And what I know, and what you guys all know, is that there are choices about where you put your stake, where you put your efforts, what you push, and what you don't push. There are choices. And what I hear, and I'm not expert about this, I follow this sort of on the periphery, and I came tonight because I heard on the radio station that there was this forum, is that you have a very serious credibility gap. And I know you've walked into that, Commissioner Tierney, and it sounds like you may be a little responsible in your role as a prior role as an attorney for part of that. I don't know that, I'm just speculating. But here are the areas that I see you have a really serious credibility problem. One is, we heard from the person in Hinesburg
that the Vermont Gas lied about wetlands. Lied. L-I-E-D, lied. I don't care if it's the Agency of Natural Resources. I would hope that your experts would be reviewing that independently. There are maps out there. This is not a big yay. But that apparently did not happen before you got there. There's also, they lied about the cost. If the cost has gone, you know, skyrocketed. And what it sounds to me like what didn't happen with the prior Public Service Department was the prior Public Service Department was not a strong enough advocate to say, stamp their feet and scream and yell and appeal if they can or do whatever they could to say, this is unacceptable, that there should be this expansion of cost, that this is a fraud on the Public Service Board, on the rate of the people in Vermont, and we need to do something about it. Thirdly, there's the issue of safety violations. There are ways to stop things. One of the ways is to look at some little thing that they're doing wrong and go after them. And what I hear from people here, I don't know this myself, is that safety violations have not been followed aggressively. You see a safety violation in June, you can issue something in June. You don't have to, and I understand there is this thing that happens in Vermont where we try to work with people. But when you find that you're working with a deceptive, unreliable entity on the other side, as it appears from my limited knowledge that Vermont Gas is, then I would hope that every single one of you, including you, Commissioner Tierney, would be looking to say, it looks like we made some bad mistakes. What can we do now with the information we have to make sure this doesn't continue? Whether it's financial information here, whether it's engineering information, whatever it is, you have some real credibility gaps to heal. And so far, what I keep hearing from the other attorneys, they're not recovered yet, so they maybe don't try to have it together, is, it's a done deal, we really can't do anything. And I know, and they know, and you know as an attorney, that's not the case. Yeah.
I don't used to speak to large crowds, so I have to read it. My name is Ulrike von Molke.
Yes. Mrs. Tierney, let me invite you for a moment to leave this room, putting all argumentation aside, and to take you over to Moncton, where Sam Jessup, a man in his 30s, is sitting in a tree way up high on a small platform. It's June of last year. He's been sitting there for over a week, withstanding all kinds of weather, while below, VGS's construction company, Michaels, is felling tree after tree around him to clear the path for the fracked gas pipeline. And let me take you from here to a pipeline station in North Dakota, where in October, Sam joins four other people to turn the valves in together five states where the tar sands flow from Canada into the United States. Immediately after they do this, they each call the companies so no one gets harmed. They are not young hotheads. They are clear-sighted men and women who have fought for many years all kinds of legal and political battles to protect our planet's future from more extreme climate disaster. They also act in solidarity with the Sioux tribes' opposition to the North Dakota Access Pipeline that is threatening the tribes' lives and rights. These valve turners have come to realize that as no help is coming from government, we have to take things into our own hands with direct action if we are to have a chance to bring about change at the last minute. They are facing heavy charges with many years, possibly up to 30, 40 years in prison. For one of them, Ken Ward, in his 60s, it could mean the rest of his life. They are not contending the illegality of their actions. On the contrary, they make videos of them to show to the prosecution and the jury, together with scientific evidence of the climate change impacts we are already and will be experiencing. They are doing these acts out of a sense of urgency, and they are doing them for all of us, as we are all in it together, including our children and grandchildren. I have heard you several times speak of your heart tonight, and I would ask you to take these actions, these courageous actions of these people, into your heart.
thank you for the opportunity to speak. My name is Gwendolyn Hall-Smith, and I'm here as a citizen and as a volunteer with Vermonters for a New Economy. We're currently working on getting the state tax dollars out of TD Bank, which funds pipelines all over the country. And we need your help. We need your help. But I'm here as a former regulator and permit granter, so I know something about the job that you're doing. And I know that you do have choices. Regulation and permits do not work like a machine. They work with real clear human choices in every step along the way. And I agree wholeheartedly with the people here who have said that ultimately, as regulators, you're faced with a moral choice. Your views of what you're doing on a macro level and a large scale do play a role in that. Permits also aren't indelible rights written into law forever. They are permissions and privileges granted with conditions. And those conditions usually require that the permittee performs in a particular way. Now, one question I have for you that I also had about the North Dakota Access Pipeline and have the happenstance to be able to question James Dalton, who was the person at the Army Corps of Engineers responsible for those permits back in November. I asked him lots of questions about what alternatives had been looked at for that pipeline. Why was a pipeline going under a mile lake that served the drinking water needs of 17 million people downstream when alternatives that were a lot less harmful were available? I asked the same question about why a pipeline in Vermont is going under a wetland in a public park that was set aside for wildlife. What alternatives were ever looked at as available? Now, it turned out that an EIS had never been done on the Dakota Access Pipeline, and he actually went back to Washington and ordered that EIS be done. Was an EIS ever done on this? Were alternatives ever looked at that would have taken this pipeline, first of all, eliminating it, and second of all, not putting it under critical wildlife habitat? Thank you.
Yeah. That's a direct question.
Yeah, the question was whether an environmental impact assessment was done on the project. And
Hi, Gwen. An environmental impact statement or analysis wasn't done in the sense of the federal requirement, because that's required for federal actions. But in the review in the 248 process, which is the process in the state where we look at these, we did look at alternatives, and our analysts that sponsored expert testimony in the case looked at the baseline scenario of the Vermont gas pipelines and what benefits that would provide. It looked at, you know, what if you have the pipeline and it expanded and enhanced efficiency efforts that could be delivered by Vermont Gas, which is an efficiency utility at this point, what kind of benefits do those bring? And then it also looked at, what if you serve just the larger industrial customers with compressed natural gas or with liquefied natural gas? And they ran economic analyses through an economic modeling tool that we use at the department, and came up with a result that showed clear economic benefits from the...
She's asking about environment, not economic.
I'm sorry about that. Part of the analysis also took into account the greenhouse gas impacts associated, is that?
He asked about the pipeline, where it went through a public park, through a wetland. Was there any environmental study, impact study done on the environmental aspects, not the broad ones, the on the ground ones?
Okay.
There
were
alternatives.
There were, and they admitted it in testimony that they never, VGS never examined going around the park. They never asked for easements of any property owners around the park. They just more economical to go right through the wetlands, and they lied as to where the wetlands were because they thought they could have just bullied their way through.
And they chose horizontal drilling so that they didn't have to get a wetland permit, which is really disturbing.
Because it's leaking already.
So they don't have to get a wetland permit.
Okay, so I apologize because I think I misunderstood your question initially and was thinking about the broader benefits, cost benefits that are associated with the project. So I apologize for that.
But environmental benefits, not cost.
So there's 2 points.
But the whole thing is that until TJ4, whoever he is, introduced Howard's work in June of 2013, all that was ever considered was CO2 emissions at the flame tip. That was the environmental determination that was made about methane. That was it. Nothing about leaking. And once they said, oh, that's a different methodology, we'll run with the EPA, never looked at it again. That question of methane leaks and the methane contribution as a driver of climate change was never looked at again.
Okay.
Real failure.
If I can step back, I want to try and be responsive, and I apologize because I think I'm doing a terrible job at this. But I'm going to give it my best shot, if that's okay. With respect to the route, I understand that focus of the comments I've been hearing has to do with Pratt's Park. And my understanding is during the time that there was not an alternative looked in the CBG proceeding around that particular parcel. That did not come up in that case. It was reviewed by our environmental agency, ANR, and the wetlands issues were addressed by, and they were evaluated and they were reviewed by ANR in the course of that proceeding. With respect to other parts of the route, actually alternatives were looked at. There was there were CBG proceedings after the initial one that looked at reroutes around the old State Road portion of the pipeline in Moncton. So I think where there were concerns raised at the time where they were found, there were alternatives reviewed to those specific parcels. But I do not think that with respect to Jeprags Park at the time of the initial certificate, there, at least within the case, there were alternatives looked at. I hope that's helpful.
Guys, just have a quick follow-up question. I've heard a lot, and I haven't been following this particular case myself for all these years, like the people here have, which is why I waited to ask. But I've heard a lot tonight about things that have happened since the initial certificate of public good was granted that may well be enough to open it up again. And say, wait 1 minute, you need to go to the environment. For a certificate of public good anymore, and we really should relook at it. And I would hope that that would be the case here tonight, that you would go away from this hearing thinking that maybe, maybe it's worth reopening. And the only other quick follow-up question is, there are no federal permits involved in this pipeline when it goes across state lines?
This is an intrastate pipeline, so usually, can I take this again? Most pipelines get their licenses or their certificates from the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission, and that's because they deliver gas in interstate commerce. So the licensing authority is FERC, and as part of that process, they have to follow NEPA, which is the federal law that requires environmental assessment and an EIS. In the case of Vermont Gas, this is an intrastate pipeline that operates wholly within Vermont. And for that reason, the certificate comes from the state.
Gas comes from Canada.
We're not producing any gas.
Hi, my name is Joseph Gaines. I live in Marshfield, Vermont, and I want to thank you all for being here. I know this isn't easy. And I want to thank all of you. You folks are absolutely amazing. You are great. I am so proud of all of you. And so I just want to express a concern that I have in the way you might be looking at your job. Are you looking at it broadly? Are you looking at it narrowly? You've had enough information here to know that we're thinking, when we think about public, we're thinking about non-human life. We're thinking about generations in front of us. We're thinking about a much broader public that includes people in Pakistan, all around the world. That's how we define public. The other thing I would ask you to think about is, how do you define cost? Are you talking about money cost? Or are you talking about the cost to civilization and life on this planet and all the cities that were enumerated before that will be underwater if we continue the way we're going? So I want you to think about how you construe your job. Is it narrow? Is it broad? And there's one other thing I want to ask you, good people, and I do believe you are good people. I want you to think about how I'm doing my job, I'm doing my duty, has resonated throughout history in very terrible ways.
Yes.
I just wanted to respond to the statement that it's a done deal and we don't have any impact. And I would like to know, do we get a vote? Can we vote on this kind of thing? Going forward, how would we impact something that's coming down the pike? You're looking for input that would be representative. And voting would give you an idea of what that would be.
Hi, I'm Cisco. Thank you. I appreciate your comments with regard to the questions that were asked about alternate routes and certificate of public good. I'd like to beg you a moment to answer that gentleman's question about the methane tests that were used to determine in your study of the CPG. Pardon me. I've got two things that I wanted to say. The first is a specific question. I'll direct it to the inspecting boss there. The second is something that I have to say to everybody in the room. So let me get to the first one. I may have a wrist arrest to take this photograph. I'll give it to you. Let me, here, this for you. How deep is this pipeline supposed to be buried?
I'm not sure where this is.
I am. I'll take it.
What's the
name of it? I'll listen to
your information.
Okay, yeah, the rest of my information is a statement to the entire group.
He wants to hear the rest of where's the pipeline now, so he can answer your question.
It's in that 41-mile pipeline that is under discussion tonight, and I'll be glad to take you there. And while you answer my questions, how deep is it supposed to be? A minimum.
Well, I'm afraid I have to say it depends. Yep. So the federal code, minimum code for pipeline safety, is that transmission lines are buried 3 feet unless they have provisions to provide the same protection from damage as 3 feet would be. Now, in this pipeline, there were agreements made in several areas, agricultural areas, wetland areas and such, that designate depths other than 3 feet, including an agreement with Velco for when they want to utilize heavy equipment to access their facilities.
Could you put the microphone closer?
Sure. So I'm afraid I have to say it depends.
Is that a deeper requirement or a lesser requirement?
Which is a deeper requirement?
It's the one for Velco, so in a deeper requirement than 3 feet or lesser requirement?
It's an agreement between Velco and...
More or less than 3 feet?
The agreement was 4 feet rather than 3 feet.
So minimum 3 feet, maybe 4 or 5 feet in some place.
But it's not always a minimum. If you can provide the same protection with other means, the safety codes allow you to do that. This particular pipe is coated with concrete, this section here. I can at least recognize that physical fact. So this is different than the majority of the pipe that is in that 41 miles.
I do have one additional piece of information
I'd like to give you, and that is it is my understanding that there was an agreement across this property that pipe was supposed to be buried 5 feet. That was the agreement.
How deep do you think that is?
I don't know how deep this is. The pipe looks larger than you would expect. I mean, the pipe is a 12-inch pipe, but when it's covered with concrete, it's going to look larger. So I'm not sure what the fact is.
It might be 5 inches.
I would assert that measuring from the center of the pipe, which I think the way you do it, right?
No, you measure from the top of the pipe.
From the top of the pipe, okay.
Yes, right.
Okay, you just gave me another...
It's more stringent than what you just assumed, yes.
Right. From the top of that pipe, it's not a foot below grade.
It hasn't been regraded. I'm not sure of all the facts.
Is it something that could be followed up on after tonight with the department engineers?
Absolutely. Yes.
And the other thing that I wanted to say to the assembled group. I've heard some intelligent answers from this side. I've been amazed at what's been said on this side. I came into this fight for my grandchildren's grandchildren. And I'm sorry. We didn't make it. If this is the best, the little state of Vermont, I moved here 15 years ago. Because I thought this was a place to be a good place to survive. And I think of what we've got here is the best that democracy can produce. And if this is it, we're doomed.
Yeah.
Good night.
I'm Karen Bixler, I'm from East Bethel. You said your personal opinion would be put to the side. There's a buzzword around these days, it's called worldview. We see the world through our lenses, and we see them very differently depending upon where we come from, what our background is. A lot of us are grasping very hard to try to change our worldviews because we realize that we grew up in an exploitive racist society and that we've kind of been on the taking side of that and we're trying to turn that around. And I want to say to you that your decisions, your worldview is going to influence those decisions, and I don't care how hard you try to be the good soldier, and as Joseph said, sometimes being the good soldier is not the right decision. Thank you.
I live in South Burlington. I'm the director of 350 Vermont, but that's not how I'm speaking to you today. I want to talk to you today actually as a person of faith, deep faith, because following very closely on what Joseph and Karen and others have said. And that is, I want you all to look at me and ask yourselves, whoever is your God, whoever is your higher power, whoever you... whatever thing above you that you answer to, what would that thing, it, he, she, them, do? Because, you know, these strange things are happening right now, and it's just getting stranger, right? It's great. I totally hear you, June, when you say, I got to follow my oath and I got to follow my job description. That's when democracy works. Democracy isn't working right now. And if you don't think that's the case, you got to open your eyes. It's not working in Vermont. It's not working in this nation. So, you know, when you're presented in your daily job to do something that is putting someone at risk that you know morally is wrong, think about, I've been struck by these customs officials, right, who have put a 5-year-old in handcuffs. Now, that's a real obvious one, right? And some of us can say, oh no, I wouldn't be that person. But those are everyday people just like you and probably just like me too. What Trump is doing for us, though, it's giving us a vision into what we're going to be dealing with climate real soon. And the same decisions that might seem really obvious when we're up against a fascist authoritative leader, we are up against those same questions, but this time it's physics with chemistry. And there's no turning back, either. There's turning back with Trump. Thank you.
I've got two questions. Can you talk about some of the benefits that the pipeline provides that you balanced against these other considerations? And is natural gas, according to your understanding, any cleaner or less likely to lead to global warming than wood heat or heating oil?
Can you identify yourself, please?
Yes, please.
I'm Mike Paul Hamas. I'm a reporter with Vermont Air.
Mike, I am at a loss as to how to deal with your question, because as I've said more than once tonight, I am here and the folks I work with are here to hear from people who have very clear views about this pipeline. I'm happy to be schooled by people present. I appreciate that you're doing your job if you are visiting retribution upon me because I said scandalous things about journalists earlier. I apologize. My sense of integrity says it's not appropriate for us to go there.
Answer the question.
Yeah. I just said what I believe to be the case, which is that it's not appropriate for me to be discussing the benefits of a project with so many of you. Because so many of you tonight have spoken so clearly in your views about this pipeline project, and this evening is about you. What brought us here tonight, that is my view. That is what brought me here tonight. It was the people who came to my office, who spoke to me about the need for this forum, and we've been listening very carefully and very attentively to the views of people who feel very strongly about this pipeline. This is not a forum tonight, in my view, to debate the pros and cons and to create false parity about this issue. So, Mike, I don't think I'm going to answer those questions here.
So where is the debate if it's not here? It's obviously not at the Public Service Board, unless you're a millionaire and you can afford enough lawyers to go up against Vermont Gas, which is really Anchorage. So where is the debate? I mean, we don't vote for you. We vote for a governor. That's already one step removed. What about the Public Service Board? They make rules at the level of legislation. Why? Because the legislature doesn't take responsibility. It says you make the rules. Three people who aren't elected. Where's the debate, and where is the part that the public can play in making decisions?
I'm done. They're not following process either, though, on answering questions.
My name is Barry, and I am also cursed with possession of an attorney's license. And there were four words that are often used in the legal context that I think really can help focus this discussion. Two of them have to do with how decisions are made. There's ministerial and there's discretionary. A ministerial decision is what a zoning administrator does. Is the setback actually 25 feet to take a tape measure, you measure. If it's 25 feet, it gets the permit. If it's 24 feet, it has to go to the conditional review board, which has the discretion to consider public good and things like that. If your job is to determine if the mission of the department is to serve all citizens of Vermont through public advocacy, planning, and other actions that meet the public needs, etc., that certainly is not ministerial. That is discretionary. You have the right, you have the obligation to make decisions as what you think is in the public interest. And the public interest is not just rates.
Nobody defines themselves as ratepayers. We are citizens.
Bravo.
Right? A project like this one concerns all the citizens of Vermont and all citizens of the world because of the effects of global warming. And the other two words are citizen and ratepayer. Every ratepayer is a citizen. Not every citizen is a ratepayer. And being a ratepayer is not part of who anybody thinks of themselves as. You know, it's a minor part of their life, but it's how you, both department and the Public Service Board, define citizens. It's as, you know, is this going to benefit them by costing a little bit more or a little bit less? And not looking at the whole citizen. And the whole citizen cares about a lot more than ratepayers.
My name is Rick Barstow from Advance, and I just want to say that we are at a time in history like no other. This is a time to think about things differently, think out of the box in terms of how we make decisions regarding this pipeline, this applies to decisions being made all over this planet right now. The science is, you know, the physics of what's going on right now doesn't care about what's happening in this room. It doesn't care what about anything. It's going full steam ahead, and we're in a race.
Just give it 5 minutes of patience and let's not wiggle out of here if anybody can stay. Let's all leave when we're quit.
We are in a race against time, and we're like, who is it? Nero fiddling while the planet is burning? I think that's the situation right now. And so we better figure out how to put this fire out quick.
Good evening, and thank you for the forum. My name is Bob Ashton. I'm the energy coordinator for Plainfield as a volunteer. I'm employed in the state of Vermont as a paid employee. I realize every day when I get up that I pay my taxes, and essentially I'm paying my own salary. So therefore, I'm accountable to myself, number one. I think that you, June, and your board and advisors have the choice to make the right decision. We elected the person who appointed you, so we have a little bit of investiture in what you do. The impact on the planet is in our face. We have to leave this in the ground. Every little bit that we do or avoid doing is a nail either in the coffin or averted from the coffin. We're killing the planet. It's within all our morality to do something about it. We have shaky engineering going on. What the heck is an inadvertent release? It's a freaking spill, okay? You, Mr. Engineer, you, Mr. Environmentalist person, you could be out there in your boots, in your hard hat, in your vest, and looking at that, all this shaky stuff. If I was buying a car, and the first day I did it, the door fell off, I'd say, well, I don't think I'm gonna drive in that car anymore. So look into your heart, look into your minds, look into your education, look into the faces of the people in here, and those are your grandchildren, and shut this down. You don't have to shut it down completely. You can wake up tomorrow morning and say, stop, enough already, we need to look again. Thank you.
My name's David Scopin, I live in Essex, and I have one thing to say. You've got a lot of people that got your back if you make the right decision. So don't feel as though you're out there and you're going to be stoned when you make the right decision. Everyone in this group, including myself, we've got your back.
Let me be super brief, but you mentioned before that the pipeline was pretty much like set to go, and you're looking mostly for things for going forward. So I have a suggestion for that I won't have time to say, but if you want to, I'll try and catch you guys afterwards and give that to you. And question for you following up on Heidi's question. You said that you don't have jurisdiction going forward, so I was wondering if there was any sort of body or anything that does have the ability right now to stop the pipeline where it is.
So the question is there any entity that has the authority to shut down both the pipeline from a legal basis at this point?
The CPG was appealed to the Supreme Court, and that appeal was ultimately withdrawn. In addition to that, CLF had filed a petition with the board, much like I believe it was a speaker over here asked, to reopen the CPG, and that proceeding is still pending before the board.
What?
What does that
mean? Vermont Law School, I said pending?
No, Conservation Law Foundation.
So what do we do?
There have been several issues been brought up here. Law. We should abide the law. I studied law for a brief moment. And one of the things I learned that I never forgot, that the nature, we've been talking about nature here, the nature of a law is that it comes after reality. And the reality is that a lot of laws that we started 100 years ago with the Industrial Revolution, we have to end them. And we are like a ship that is moving to a waterfall, and we don't want to get off, because we know the ship. But I think we have to turn around the ship 180 degrees. And the other thing, you are the Department of Public Service, and this has been said, you have a very important position now, because you have to have the guts to turn around. Not knowing where you're going, but you have to, I think.
My name is Arthur Blackhawk, and I'm from Essex Junction. And I think what's important is we recognize we're on occupied lands. In saying that, I'm not a lawyer. I had my shot. I want to thank the custodian for allowing us to be here. I want to thank the board for being present and offering the opportunity for the community to actually speak. The question is whether they're heard. As a storyteller, I do know the difference. Some valuable information was given to you tonight, and I want to just highlight a few of those as a storyteller. One is that you have a choice. Nothing in life is a done deal. If that were the case, we're all doomed. Okay. The other piece here is the fact that they've mentioned some choices that we make that are moral or amoral. And I don't want to lecture anybody on their own spiritual path. It is each of our own path. But it leads to where we're all going to be. And I think what's equally important is that we tell a good story in the time frame we're here. We make good choices that serve beyond ourselves. Mention service. I've been with the state of Vermont for over 20 years advocating for children. Okay. I was at Standing Rock twice helping veterans who were immobile move to that front line. I saw things there that were un-American. I'm seeing things happen in our community today that are un-American. And I suggest that if you do one thing for yourself tonight, and that is, I'm not asking you to open up your eyes, your ears, your mouths. Open up your heart. The only thing that's going to save us all is prayer. It's been the foundation of what's going on in Standing Rock. It's the foundation of a new movement in this country. And everyone in this room, I want to thank you for your service. Each and one. Thank you.
So, tonight this is a result of direct action. Direct action gets the goods.
What we have heard from these folks tonight is that there's no recourse, that this is a done deal, the pipeline's going to go through. I think I would be interested to see some proof that there's no way to reopen the CPG and reconsider phase three. Today, as we speak tonight, the tents at Standing Rock are on fire. And the people are being removed from camp by law enforcement. This is the world that we're in, law or no law. I think the questions of ethics or morality are all of ours personally, like Arthur said. Thank you so much for all of that. I think that if it is true that there's no recourse here with the Department of Public Service and the Public Service Board, then our only options are to try and overwhelm the legislature by taking it to the streets, continuing with direct action, and continuing by trying to change the job descriptions of these folks up here to mirror what it is that we need from them. Well, we're all clear that we need from them. The agreements that have been made tonight include us going to the spot where that picture was taken and being able to tell with an inspector whether or not that pipe was buried substandard. I think that we also want to hear whether or not OSHA was ever called around the AC issue with the current going through the pipeline. If that was the big health issue, we never heard back from that question. But I think that tonight was a really amazing experience to actually be able to speak truth to power, even if no transactional result could come from it. And we really appreciate y'all all being here. We know, we've seen that your office is an adversarial one, but we respect each of you very much, and thank you very much. So I'd like to, the rest of the closing statements from the coalition will go to Rachel Smoker, who's been one of our hardest working advocates and agitators in recent months.
I don't know what to say. I didn't anticipate coming up here and making closing statements on this event. I do thank you for taking the time to listen to us. I guess you were sort of forced into it. And I think what we've learned is that that's the lesson that we take. We have to force these things in order to make them happen. I would like to suggest some follow-up statements.
No, I do have.
Wait a second. You're going to get your closing statements.
No, yep. I'm not. We're already way over the agreement.
Well, you can wait. Rachel's going to finish off.
Okay, I just
no,
want
my
to.
Point,
you can,
no, I
in
to
one
make
second.
This point. You could have asked for a meeting, and I would have given you one. There was no need for it.
Okay, fine.
That's very important to me because that's coming from my heart.
Okay, well, I think people have been asking. It's very frustrating.
I would have done as your public servant, and I would ask in the future that you simply ask.
We will ask, but I hope you can understand how frustrating this is for people who have been fighting and fighting and fighting. I would like to suggest some follow-up steps, which is, from my perception, it's very clear that what we need to do is to reopen the certificate of public good. You are part of it. I think it must be possible. I would like to ask that you really lay out for us why it is that that isn't possible. If it is possible, as was said earlier, we have your back, okay? There is new information that has come out about the environmental impacts of fracked gas and about this pipeline, and we know that Vermont Gas has failed in many respects in terms of living up to the conditions of the Certificate of Public Good. And they should have been challenged and their feet should have been held to the fire, but they weren't. So my follow-up step is I would really like us to be able to sit down. I'm asking that we sit down and have a serious discussion about how we can reopen the Certificate of Public Good and revisit this whole thing from the ground up. Not a done deal.
Bravo.
Thank you all for coming. Thank you for treating each other as respectfully and as thoughtfully as you did. There was what you can expect from here is that I will try to gather people's notes, put together a summary in draft form, and email it to anyone who signed up on the sheet back there. That's why we had the sign-up sheet, so that you could get a draft copy of the summary, so we want to make sure that it's reflective of what was said. And so if you would like to be a part of that process, Please sign up if you haven't already. And please, again, thank you for coming. But if you could, we could get out of here quickly, that would be great, because the poor custodian is on overtime and he probably has time. So thanks for respecting him.